Hello and a warm welcome to another edition of To The Point. On the show this week, strategic and foreign policy analyst, politician and journalist Seshadri Chari. Welcome on To The Point. Starting with you on what the BRICS declaration has been. Today we saw when the German declaration was came out, we saw that for the first time, the terror outfits JEM and LET have been named. Do you see this as a significant move, or is it some kind of a very symbolic victory for India?
No, I think it's both symbolic victory and significant both. See, this BRICS summit basically is not about just terrorism. It's not even about strategic outreach of countries who are members and non-members. These are all peripheral issues, or let us say secondary issues. The primary issue of this particular BRICS, in fact, BRICS itself is more of an economic forum and less of a political or strategic forum. So these bilateral strategic outreaches of these countries are one thing, which is an ongoing process. And even bilateral relationships are also very important, of course, for the member countries, but they are not the dominating features of the BRICS summit. What is more important for the BRICS summit as such is the idea of the word may sound a little odd, but the Commonwealth of Economic Development.
Right.
So how Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa can come together, pool their resources, human resources, natural resources, resources of economy, scale of economy, and circumvent the common problems that they face. The most important problem that all these countries face is issues of, say, what we call the headwind challenges. So this particular summit takes into consideration the headwind challenges.
But Mr. Chari, isn't it ironical? Because obviously the objective is to come on an economic platform and pool in your objectives as far as the economic objectives are concerned. But media always grabs those headlines which are largely political. For example, this BRICS summit, it seemed as if, you know, terrorism was the only agenda on the anvil.
No, there is a reason for it. I won't blame the media as much in this also, because terrorism, incidentally, terrorism has become one of the biggest impediments of economic growth. So, like India is concerned about terrorism, India's economic growth also is being impeded by terrorism. Similarly, Chinese also are facing grave threats to their economic growth prospects through terrorism. So they don't also look at terrorism from the point of view of making use of terrorism as a strategic tool in dealing with A, B, C country.
You're making a very important point when you're saying that terrorism impedes the economic growth. Is that the reason why China actually agreed to come on board? Because if you look at the 48th paragraph of the 43-page declaration, we see that there are other outfits also which have been named, like ISIS, Eastern Turkestan Islamic Movement, Islamic Movement of Uzbekistan. So do we read this as some kind of a shifting stand of China? Has it really changed its position?
Yes, you're right. We can say to some extent China has changed its position.
Okay.
Because China has taken into consideration the ground realities. For China, which wants to really go very deep into Africa, they want to have an access to the African markets through a shorter and possibly a viable route. Plus, they have got ambitious projects like OBOR.
Right.
All these projects can go for a toss if they are faced with resistance, local resistance. For example, China is facing a huge amount of local resistance in Balochistan.
Right.
Now, Balochistan is an issue, is a problem for Pakistan. Balochistan is an issue for India. Just as we have raised issues as far as China-Pakistan economic corridor is concerned, vis-a-vis Pak-occupied Kashmir. We don't want that road to go through Pak-occupied Kashmir.
But Mr. Chari, given the fact that it's very difficult to predict China's intransigence, and also the fact that the terror outfits have been named in the German declaration, how seriously does one take the declaration that China is really going to walk the talk.
No, it's true, because see, China is also facing a lot of problems as far as I won't really call it 100% terrorism, but local resistance is concerned. China had a very serious problem in Myanmar, for example, when North Myanmar was offered to China for building of infrastructure support base and industrialization process of Myanmar. China had moved huge number of equipments, construction equipments. They had pumped in a lot of money and they had pumped in a lot of people into the North Myanmar areas. And this created a destabilization of the society in that area. So people resisted, so much so that some of the important assets of China which were built there were destroyed. Army had to move in and army had to finally tell the Chinese communists to withdraw, companies to withdraw. So it is not only terrorism. Terrorism adds and joins the local resistance force. For example, like in Balochistan, as I was saying. So in Balochistan, China is facing a huge serious problem, plus the Baluchi rebels who want independence from Pakistan. So all these things put together can create problems for China.
So am I to assume from what you are saying that has that realization dawned on China finally that it cannot have double standards when it comes to tackling the menace of terrorism?
Obviously. To some extent, China might have thought that as long as terrorism is a trouble for India, why should we condemn Pakistan? Especially in a situation where Pakistan is rolling out the red carpet for China for their infrastructure projects and also to give access to China into the Indian Ocean region. But this doesn't come free. So China also has to face its own terrorism problems in Xinjiang province, in Uyghurs rebellion. And sooner or later, they probably have realized that the most peace-loving people of Tibet may not remain peaceful forever. Plus, there could also be some elements within the Chinese territory who could be probably siding with some rebel forces. There are forces. Remember, China and India both share northern borders with Myanmar, and it's a very porous border. So just as we had problems from insurgent groups,
they also
have their own share of insurgency problems from Myanmar also they could have. So China also has realized the importance of tackling this issue of terrorism. Plus, on a global forum, it does not help China to take a standalone attitude as far as terrorism is concerned. You cannot say that we will keep dealing with countries on economic basis, but as far as terrorism is concerned, we will turn a blind eye. You cannot say.
But given the track record earlier, what China's stand has been, they have always blocked the listing of Jaish-e-Mohammed chief, as
correct,
a global terrorist.
Correct.
Now, if you look at the Amritsar declaration, which happened in 2016, they at that time also LET and JEM were listed as part of the terror groups, which should be discouraged completely. So, but then also China's attitude changed, and we saw the way Doklam happened and various standoffs we have seen. So China's attitude basically has been that of a very negative character. It has been of dual standards. So how seriously should one take this stance, which is coming from Xiamen?
See, when in international dealings and diplomacy, you can never take anybody at face value. Okay. A. B. You can never say that China's stand or Pakistan's stand or US stand or India's stand is permanent and non-negotiable and not changeable. These things have an ever-changing nature because of the ever-changing dynamics of geopolitical situation. So you have to see the reality and also adjust that reality to the existing situations. That is exactly what China has done, and that is exactly what India has also done.
Right.
And if you see, for example, this particular BRICS theme, they had very specifically mentioned that the interplay of traditional and non-traditional security risks, as well as the anti-globalization and protectionism tendency, especially sources of concern. So traditional and non-traditional security risk is a matter of concern. That is the theme of this BRICS. And what are the traditional and non-traditional security risk and concern? India is facing a traditional security risk from terrorism. China is facing a security risk from Balochistan, Sindh and Pak-occupied Kashmir areas.
Right.
And now with their OBOR, they may face much more greater resistance from some of the African countries also and some of the Silk Road countries. So they have also realized the importance of tackling the issue of terrorism headlong and also saying it so. So it's a welcome change and I hope China maintains this stand.
If I were to read out one part of the declaration, which actually I would like to quote, and it says that we recall the responsibility of all states to prevent financing of terrorist networks and terrorist actions from their territories and call for expeditious finalization and adoption of the Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism. So are we to assume that this kind of a stand which China has taken, is it going to lead to some kind of a depletion in the ties between China and Pakistan? Are we to assume that there will be some kind of an unease between the two nations from here on?
See, I can see your focus of this question.
Right.
You know, to a very large extent, we have been maintaining, and there are some elements within Pakistan also who have been maintaining that China-Pakistan economic corridor is really not going to help Pakistan in any manner whatsoever. So it will create more disparity among the groups within Pakistan. Now, this fact we had highlighted. China wanted a strategic move in order to get a foothold in the Indian Ocean region. Now they have got it. Having got that, what is important for China now is to get India on board. Pakistan is really not going to help them as far as economic prospects are concerned. Pakistan is giving them only a way. They are only providing the route. And China is developing the road. China is developing the infrastructure inside Pakistan. Now, this infrastructure is of no use to Pakistan if China decides to withdraw, A. B, if China is able to maintain this infrastructure in spite of a fragmented Pakistan, China still is a winner. So, why should China bother about Pakistan, which is of absolutely no economic value to Chinese goods or in China as an economic entity.
Right.
So, India is of a greater economic value and entity as
compared
far as
to Pakistan.
China is concerned.
But another interesting thing which we actually saw was that incidentally there was no statement from Prime Minister Modi on the mention of Pakistan at the plenary session. And for example, at the Goa summit, he actually referred to Pakistan as the mothership of terrorism and he also said that terrorism has become its favorite child. So, why do you think, what is your analysis? Was it a deliberate attempt by Prime Minister Modi not to mention about Pakistan in the declaration?
No, it's a very calibrated speech that Prime Minister Modi has made.
Okay.
And I mean, we had made this statement in Goa with a view to highlight this project, prospect, this aspect as far as China and other BRIC nations were concerned. Now, it is important for us to give them a sort of a time to understand and realize the situation. Thankfully for us, Pakistan has provided that much of education as far as terrorism is concerned to these countries, especially China and Russia. Even Afghanistan is worried about the terror emanating from Pakistan. So in this kind of a situation, it was best for us not to raise this issue again. We could have easily, Prime Minister Modi could have very easily said, I said so. But it's very difficult in international arena to prudently refrain from saying this, especially when the other country, especially a country like China, has realized the importance of what India had said in Goa. So now China has realized the fact, the importance of what Narendra Modi said in Goa.
Right.
So it is better that we leave it at that. So it's always, diplomacy, it is always good to speak less and make the other party realize the importance of what we had said earlier.
But also on the sidelines of the BRICS summit, there was a bilateral meeting which happened between Prime Minister Modi and Xi Jinping. And they said that there is a closer need for to communicate, for the two countries to communicate as far as the security personnel and the defense personnel are concerned. But given the geopolitical agendas which both the nations have, how far is it really practical that the things will roll out in a manner in which they have aimed for? There are a lot of doubts on this front.
No, we have specifically said that we are not against any economic venture that any respective country takes, say like India's economic venture with Afghanistan or Iran for that matter. So when Chabahar port was being conceived, that whole idea, there were some think tanks even in the US, even in UK, and even in India, for example, were trying to place Chabahar as a competitor for say Baluchistan or as a competitor for Gwadar. But we said we are not in competition with China anywhere. Chabahar is a commitment that we made long back. For some reason, we could not go ahead with it. And then there were sanctions on Iran and all that. So we were part of an international community. So now, since the sanctions have been relaxed, we have moved in. We are not a rogue country which would probably side with Iran even when the whole world doesn't want us to do that. So we were waiting for a opportunity to get into Iran's economic infrastructure creation, and we went into Chabahar. So these are all in ideas, bilateral economic engagements, which are of a long-standing nature. So every country respects these, but at the same time, security is a major concern for all those who are engaging in these kind of economic activities. For example, any infrastructure improvement project that we undertake in Afghanistan can be sabotaged by Pakistan because of their own intrinsic interest with Afghanistan. They don't want India to get into that kind of a situation. But today, China and India are both looking at infrastructure development in Afghanistan. And for both of us, the biggest impediment are those terror, non-state terror actors in Pakistan. So this realization that China is now coming to realize is very good in a way.
So the entire backbone of the BRICS summit, from what you are saying, and I'm going to assume on that, that the whole positive atmospherics which has come out between India and China. But looking at the fact that there is about a 3,800 kilometer mountainous frontier which exists between the two nations, it is not demarcated. So from here on, how do the two countries really resolve the border dispute? Is it really going to be on, or are we going to see some kind of a prickly relationship between India and China? How do they really resolve the border dispute?
No, if you go through the speech made by Xi Jinping, he has very clearly highlighted the concerns that India had. India was all along saying that a border dispute should not come in the way of our long-standing relationship or economic engagement. And that is exactly what Xi Jinping has said. He has very categorically suggested that he is prepared to work with India, and then peace and tranquility in the border should be maintained. And more importantly, the most important aspect of the Indian and Chinese thinking as far as this particular BRICS summit is concerned is that we will not allow differences to develop into disputes. So border difference, or even differences as far as security is concerned, even differences as far as economic engagement is concerned, should not spin off into a dispute.
So this is basically upholding the Astana spirit which was seen in
absolutely
the SCO summit.
That is the spirit that with which China is prepared to move. And India is equally reciprocated. They have said that this is a forward-looking summit and not a backward-looking summit. So we are not going back into what happened 2 months back or 2 years back, but we are looking at what is to happen in future.
how does one see the trust deficit at the moment? Because multilateral forums, whenever these countries meet on the multilateral forums, there's some kind of a consensus because of the vested interest, because of the economic compulsions, all what you have listed out. But still, when you talk about India-China relationship, there's a lot of trust deficit. And both the nations see each other with a lot of doubt. So after, especially after the Doklam standoff has been resolved, do you see some kind of a new normal between the two nations?
I think so, because both China and India have realized the importance of institution building. See, some of the finest, or rather finest or not finest is a matter of jury, the jury is still out. But some of the major institutions like the IMF, the World Bank, the World Trade Organizations have all been built by Western societies. So these are all seen as instruments in the hands of the Western world to control the economic prosperity of the whole world. For the first time, China is also talking of building institutions. India has been always suggesting that we should build our own institutions. And if you see,
But institution building is fine, Mr. Chari, but what about the hegemonic ambitions of China? Are the BRIC nations not wary of China's hegemonic ambitions?
Obviously, that's what we have been raising. That is why BRICS has been able to break that ice to a very large extent. So, if you see, out of four major economies of the world, three are on this side of the hemisphere.
Right.
USA, China, Japan, India, out of which Japan, India, China, three huge economies are on one side of the world. And BRICS is one of the most important platforms on which these three economies are going to stand and thrive. Our problems are common, the poverty is common, developmental aspects are common, developmental aspirations are common, the population which we cater to is something like 67 to 80% of the world population is in these three countries, and plus BRICS plus countries. So if you see that kind of an aspect, one country with hegemonic aspiration cannot really succeed. That is why China is also talking. In fact, the very theme of this BRIC conference is of institution building. It is of respecting civilizational superiority and aspects.
But two institutions I'm going to ask you on are the Business Council and the New Development Bank, which were created within the BRIC economies. What are the challenges which you really see as far as the prioritization of projects is concerned and raising funds within the sovereign nations are concerned? They still seem to be a very big challenge. So in the larger context, if you see, how are these institutions really going to cope with these problems?
Right. I mean, raising capital is going to be one of the huge problems. That is why we have not,
the BRICS Bank. The fact that the economies are slowing down. There's a general economic slowdown.
You know, there is a general lack of enthusiasm in the economy of the world. This is what the theme of this particular conference is also recognized. So, in that particular situation, the world economy is going to turn towards China and India as far as investment is concerned. So, you are faced with a huge problem of excessive funds with 20% of the population and excessive production and demand with the 80% of the population. So, if the capital and demand, if supply and demand don't come together, nobody benefits. So, we have to get this clear. At the same time, we both China, India, Russia, and Brazil and South Africa are all committed to contribute equally to the BRICS Bank. We have not allowed one country to contribute more than the others.
So the very fact that the format of BRICS has now changed to BRIC Plus, for example, we saw smaller nations like Mexico and Thailand attending
Goa, we had head of BIMSTEC countries. That was our idea, that we should be able to engage with the BIMSTEC countries also. And also it goes along with the Prime Minister's idea of Look East, Act East. Look East was a policy that former Prime Minister Narasimha Rao devised, but Prime Minister Narendra Modi has added Act East. So in order to Act East, we need BIMSTEC. And especially in the background of the failure of institutions like the SAARC because of the attitude of one particular country. So seeing that, it is all the more important that we not only concentrate and improve on bilateral relationships, but also build multilateral institutions with a strong basis.
Right. Another important point on which Prime Minister Modi spoke was on the need to come together and fight the tax evasion and providing technical assistance to the developing nations. Of course, that was one major point which was highlighted by Prime Minister Modi. But my question to you is that has Prime Minister Modi succeeded in silencing those domestic voices which actually cast a shadow of doubt on whether demonetization was unwarranted? Because if you talk about tax evasion and you talk about these issues on a global platform, it does have a resonance of the domestic population as well. So would he be successful in silencing those voices?
No, domestic criticisms are always there and it should be there. Healthy criticism from domestic economists is a welcome sign. But we have proved, Indian economy has proved, that it is of utmost importance that we set our own house in order as far as taxation, economic policies, and also evasion of tax is concerned. And then the most important element that we have to tackle is the issue of corruption. So demonetization has really helped us in this particular aspect. Plus, added to demonetization is the issue of GST. So with GST and demonetization, I think we have crossed number of hurdles. Now it becomes easier for us to not only deal with other Southeast Asian countries, but also open up our market for a very large section of the people and also allow our exporters to reach out to the best part of the world.
But we have seen across the world where demonetization and GST have come in. Obviously, it has been followed by a measured economic slowdown. And that is what the recent GDP figures also, which were seen, they were not very encouraging. So are we to say that the signs are worrying? Does a common man worry, or should we just wait for the fruits of the pudding?
No, I don't think we should be worried about the GDP, but we should take certain cautious steps, and whatever anomalies have been created, we should be able to correct those anomalies. But otherwise, I am not worried about GST fall as much as I would say be worried about cleaning up the taxation policies, tweaking the issues, and then creating a more industry-friendly taxation mechanism. And also, that should lay the foundation for a regional commonality of taxation policy.
Thank you, Mr. Chari. It was a pleasure talking to you. So that's it on this episode of To The Point. See you next time with another personality. Goodbye and thanks for watching.